Council on Chemical Abuse Drug and Alcohol Update on BCTV is supported by the Council on Chemical Abuse.
Hello, and welcome to the Council on Chemical Abuse Drug and Alcohol Update. My name is Yvonne Stroman. I am your host for today's program. The Council on Chemical Abuse is Berks County's single county authority. We're responsible for the planning of prevention, treatment, intervention, and recovery services. We help to coordinate these efforts so that people suffering from the disease of addiction have the best chance of getting well and sustaining long-term recovery. For centuries, alcohol has been a staple in our communities, used as a celebrant prop, a ceremonial toast, or a problem solver. Alcohol, which is also known as spirits, booze, still remains the number one drug used by youth and adults in the United States. According to the National Institute on Alcohol Abuse and Alcoholism, 85.6% of people ages 18 and older report that they have drank alcohol at some point in time in their life. The consequences of irresponsible consumption cost Americans over $200 billion, that's with a B, dollars annually in workplace productivity loss, healthcare costs, criminal justice costs, and motor vehicle crashes. Each April since 1987, the National Council on Alcohol and Drug Dependency Incorporated has sponsored Alcohol Awareness Month to increase public awareness and understanding, reduce stigma, and encourage local communities to focus on alcoholism and alcohol-related issues. The Council on Chemical Abuse develops and plans various programs and projects aimed at education and raising awareness about the effects of alcohol. With me to talk more about these activities is Sonia Santiago. She is one of our prevention specialists at the Council on Chemical Abuse. Good afternoon, Sonia. How are you?
Hi. Thank you for having me. I'm doing well. Thank you.
Thanks. Great. Thank you, Sonia. And let me just kind of start out by letting folks know, our viewing audience, you've been with the Council on Chemical Abuse for a long time. And I know you've done a series of these education awareness workshops in the classroom and outside of the classroom. But I'm wondering, for our conversation today, can you just tell a little bit about some of the work that you do and why is this topic so important, Sonia?
Well, you're right. I do a lot of presentations, and some of them do include going into schools. And the actual curriculum may involve talking about alcohol and other substances as well. So we talk a little bit about alcohol and how they can learn refusal skills and learning how to say no under peer pressure. The other thing that we also do is we go out into the community. For example, Salvation Army, which I just did, and we talk about, you know, alcohol, especially, you know, what, especially in the elderly community. And so, you know, because once, you know, they're retired, they think, you know, the golden years, they have fun, but sometimes, you know, they can get caught up with, you know, substance abuse as well, and that can tend to happen. But yeah, we're all in all, in the elementary, the middle, and the high school, and also in the community as well. So no one is immune to drinking alcohol.
I appreciate you saying that, because I'm just wondering if in your conversations, in your presentations, do you hear individuals indicating that, you know, sometimes there's that perception that alcohol is not a drug, primarily because of its existence in our communities for a number of years, right? And we don't necessarily hear about, while we hear about, you know, say no to vaping or say no to tobacco or say no to even opioids or marijuana, we don't necessarily hear that about alcohol. And I'm just wondering if there is an attitude, and rightly so, within people that you have a conversation with, that, well, alcohol isn't a drug, and so why are we even having this conversation?
Absolutely. Yeah, I have to agree. You know, even with, you know, it being 21 years and older, you know, being of legal age, you know, people tend to think that it's, you know, it's okay to drink. However, you know, we do talk about when there's alcohol involved or alcoholic family members, you know, they think that it's just, you know, on the weekends. But it also involves different ways as far as like binge drinking, which people don't really necessarily hear about. And they think that just because binge drinking is not every day, but it's just the amount of consumption that is, you know, that they drink within a certain amount of time. that it really isn't that dangerous. So yeah, alcohol is something that continuously needs to be talked about, especially, you know, in every age bracket.
So. Yeah. We have sometimes in our student data reporting that, you know, sometimes young people is 9 or 10 years old saying they're trying alcohol for the first time. And, you know, have you seen that data, has that increased at all, or has that decreased, or does it remain pretty constant based on what you're learning?
I'm not necessarily 100% sure, but one of the things that we do see is that, and we do talk about this as well in the classroom, is that, you know, the amount of teens or kids that are using are not that high. And the reason we talk about that is because we don't want them to think that, you know, it's they have to fit in or they have to be a part of, and, you know, so they have to drink just like they do. But that's, so we try to do the reverse and talk about, you know, the amount of kids that are not doing it. So it gives them, you know, a better perception, you know, and kind of like, you know, it helps them to stay away from it. So, but yeah.
And I know that there are oftentimes, and, you know, we're talking now about having conversations with youth in the classrooms and having conversation with the older population in the community, but there is a program that you help co-facilitate called Strengthening Families, where there's an opportunity to have conversation together. And I'm just wondering if you could talk a little bit about that program and why it's so important that there be a connectedness with teaching families together.
I think it's very important. I think every parent or even caretaker or, you know, guardian needs to have that conversation with their children or with their child in the home. I think they also need to learn how to talk with their kids as well, because it's not easy, you know, especially, you know, kids nowadays, they don't want parents prying into their business. And so talking about even just, you know, not just alcohol, but any other kind of, like, you know, as far as social media passwords and things like that, just having that constant conversation. And obviously there is no manual to it. So, you know, just starting the conversation just basically opens up, you know, future conversations and gains more trust for everyone. But starting at a very young age, you know, and having that open communication is key.
Yeah. How do families get involved in the Strengthening Families program? Is there a sign up? Is that networking through the schools? How does that work?
Well, there was a sign up, and that's something that, you know, we did, and you had to sign up for it. And it was very interactive. It involved a lot of activities that involved both the parent and the child or children. And so it just, you know, to build rapport, to build trust, and not just, you know, have to build all those things, but also to feel comfortable in having these conversations, because it's not always comfortable for parents to even question their child about something, you know, that they just don't want to hear the truth about. Yeah. You know, are you smoking cigarettes or are you drinking alcohol? And they kind of like want to go like this, but, you know, it is the reality. So they just have to be, they just have to know that it could come up.
Yeah. And I think, is it parents' perception sometimes, well, not my child. Oh my God, they're only 10 Absolutely. Or 11 or 12 years old. They shouldn't even, that's something that's not even considered for the parent, only to find that, you know, youth, quite frankly, are a little bit more knowledgeable than we think. And and I think parents need to understand that youth, while they may not, you know, because some parents think, well, I don't drink, my kids don't see me doing that, and so why would they? But the fact of the matter is, young people in their social development hear about this through their friends, and maybe if they're going to their friend's home where they're seeing that. And so I think, as you say, that's why that conversation is so important, because while we make the assumption, because we are not doing that at home, that youth have a perception, they're seeing it and hearing it from somewhere.
Right. And I think you made an important note there as far as seeing. And that's why it's important, you know, if we do have parents or caregivers, whomever, guardians that do drink, that, you know, they have to remember that they need to be drinking responsibly, because obviously kids do look at them as role models. And so they are their first examples of, you know, how to drink and, you know, not to get themselves into trouble.
Absolutely. And was there a cost, or is there a cost of the Strengthening Families program? Was there a, you know, family signed up? Was there a fee?
No.
Okay.
No, everything that we offer as far as prevention, all the presentations, all the curriculums that we offer, and all the programs that we offer is absolutely free at no cost. We provide all the materials, we provide all the facilitating, and you know, so there's nothing that could, you know, hold someone back as far as monetary. So it's absolutely free.
And I know that during even a time of social distancing, you still made it happen by delivering information to parents' doorsteps. And so there was safety, right? But it was still able to be implemented in a safe and healthy manner. Yeah,
absolutely. We provided every, you know, opportunity for parents to get involved. And if that meant having to do it via Zoom, then that's exactly what we did. And it worked very well. So we to try to, you know, do as much as we can to get families involved and kids as well. So that's what we did.
Seemed like a great opportunity, time to do that, given that families were home and allowing conversation to occur and what a great environment to do that. I was glad to hear that was available in Spanish and English, correct?
It was in Spanish, but it wasn't done in Spanish. It's available, I should say, in Spanish, but it was done in English. Yes. So,
okay. Yeah. Wonderful. Wonderful. So, you know, we talk about how we can extend information, raise awareness, and educate families and their youth in the homes. But we also have, and you do this very well, in the community as well. And so we have an opportunity during Alcohol Awareness Month to collaborate and partner with other organizations and community groups and even colleges to raise awareness. And so I'm wondering if you could talk about an event that's happening, I believe even tomorrow, and it's called Dance
Tomorrow
with Purpose.
Evening.
Can you kind of talk about how this came into being and what Dancing with a Purpose is for our community?
Yeah, well, you know, it's interesting, again, what you said. It just makes me think of, you know, things that I have been doing that have been all connected to alcohol. Because just last week you know, when we talk about the community, we're not just talking about parents, but we're also talking about college as well. I was just at Albright College doing a health fair, which again has to do with alcohol awareness. I was just at the RAC, Reading Area Community College, again, focusing on alcohol awareness. So it is a big to-do. Obviously it's, you know, it's that time of the year, that month, which should be not just that month, but back to what you were saying, we are having an exciting event. It's also done every year, of course, in the month of April. And so we've decided this year that we're going to go with the theme of Dancing with a Purpose. Every year is a different theme. And so we try to do something that's fun. Again, it's absolutely free. It's catered to families. So it's not just, you know, adults. But we're doing it this year, again, at Albright College. They have been more than, you know, wonderful to offer their space. And it's happening actually tomorrow evening, actually from 5 to 7. So should be exciting.
And what does the agenda look like? Is it all dancing or will there be?
sort of, kind of. But, you know, just to give you an idea, because it is Dancing with a Purpose, of course, we have to have dancing in it. So one of the first people that we're having Wanda Holdren as the salsa instructor, and you know, she's going to come and she's going to show us some salsa steps, and then obviously we're going to have some music by DJ. It's going to be there, and then the really cool part is we're going to have the actual Albright's dance team come and do a little, you know, dance for us. And then we're also going to have Albright has an instructor, and they're going to do some Zumba for us as well. So yeah, it is dancing, but again, it's going to be absolutely free. There's going to be food available, absolutely free. And our keynote speaker, her name is Rosa, and she is actually the CEO of the Palo magazine. And she's gonna take some time in bilingual, so it doesn't have to, you don't have to speak English, she could speak Spanish, and she'll be able to translate what she has to say. And it's all going to revolve around her focus is going to, her talk is going to be about binge drinking and her personal experience with that problem or that issue that she had in the past. So a lot of good stuff.
Wonderful. And you mentioned binge drinking, and I'm just wondering for our home viewers, if you could talk about what that is, what that means, binge drinking, because we hear about drinking, we hear about excessive drinking, we hear about, you know, and so binge drinking is another level of drinking. I'm just wondering
exactly
what that is.
Exactly. And we thought that, you know, because of that, we thought it would be really important to talk about, because like you said, it is a different level and not a lot of people understand. But for as far as alcohol and binge drinking, it is actually, according to statistics, it's the most common pattern of excessive alcohol use in the United States. And basically, it's the pattern of drinking usually is about maybe five drinks on a single event. But this is for men. And then it's four plus drinks on a single event for women for about 2 to 3 hours. So it's not just like drinking every day, but it's the amount of alcohol that people are drinking within a small period of time. So that's what binge drinking is.
Yeah. And I want to thank you for saying that, because I think the average person doesn't realize that depending upon your weight and your size and drinking that volume of alcohol in a short period of time can lead to alcohol poisoning. And so earlier we were talking about some statistics in terms of what happens with alcohol and excessive use of alcohol, car crashes, visits to the emergency room. But alcohol poisoning is a reality, right? That people can suffer from due to binge drinking.
Absolutely. And we hear it, you know, quite often in situations where there have been death in college campuses, you know, when they have parties and they're just drinking large amounts of alcohol, like you said, alcohol poisoning to the point where they may die because of that. So, yeah, it's an important topic to talk about, especially now with one of the things that I also wanted to mention with proms, graduation parties. And it's important to talk about, you know, with parents hosting parties as well, too. So there's a lot of legality involved in that. And a lot of parents think that just because it's being done in their home, it's safer. But in reality, it's not. So some things to think about when you're hosting a party.
And I think that's a really, really good point, Sonia, that you bring up. We're entering the spring season. Mm-hmm. And with the spring season comes the opportunity for graduations, whether it's college or whether it's high school. And the idea that, of course, as I mentioned earlier, when there's a party or a celebration, the idea that there should be alcohol, and many parents feeling that one way of being responsible is to say, well, we'll host the party here at our home, and we'll take folks' keys from them and make sure they don't go leaving here, driving under the influence. And the reality is, when you talked about binge drinking, is that excessive amount can lead to alcohol poisoning. Sometimes there's the idea, well, you know, let them sleep it off. But the reality is that it could end up being very fatal for individuals if they don't get the medical attention that they need.
Yeah, absolutely. And sometimes people, or parents, I should say, or caregivers, again, they don't think anything about it. But in actuality, it's what they call social hosting, which is obviously against the law. And there could be, you know, they could face a minimum of, according to the law, of $1,000. Second offense is $2,500, you know, and maybe possibly a lawsuit or death, maybe. So, yeah, it's a big to do. So.
That's a very valid point. And I think, you know, as we talk about this and as you share this information, hopefully folks listening understand that there are legalities behind that.
Yes.
When you're furnishing alcohol to individuals, particularly two things, under the age of 21, and then if you're choosing to furnish alcohol outside of your home, and even if the person is 21, but something happens as a result of them leaving or within your home, there's still some legal ramifications in terms of you're held accountable for the actions of individuals under your roof. And I'm just wondering, was there, you know, when you talk about partnering with Albright College in this instance, just the, was there any incidents of why Albright College was chosen? Because this has been something that has been over the years partnering with this college. How did that come into being? That I think it's neat that we're choosing a local college that's willing to promote this and host this with us. How did that partnering come into being?
I'm sure there have been issues, not necessarily just this year, but there continues to be an issue. And so they have been really doing a good job to the point where they have had kids actually answer questions anonymously. And then they, you know, just to get their feedback, I'm not sure what exactly all the questions were, but there was a survey that they did have to complete. It was anonymous, and hopefully they gather information to make things better for their college campus. So, but it was a positive thing because they were allowed to, if they filled out the survey, they get some freebies.
Well, freebies are always are very attractive and always a nice, you want to say, incentive to, to participate. And I also understand that there are actually some students at Albright who really work in concert with the prevention team to make sure that this is set up in a way that is educational and fun, right? That draws people, because we know there's a lot to be said in research as it relates to dancing. As it relates to, you know, it's not only exercise, but there's something about the brain waves and how the brain waves really kind of are, you know, energized as a result of dancing.
Sure. It's all about that dopamine, right? So if anything is going to make somebody feel good and, you know, stay positive, it certainly is either dancing and listening to music, and we've got both. So, oh, I forgot about the food part. So it's going to be quite an event. I'm really actually looking forward to it. So we do have we have Diamond Credit Union that has also, you know, collaborated with us as well, and obviously Albright has been very generous as well. So,
and I think it says a lot about the community efforts where you're having individuals that says, yes, this is something that's important that we need to help collaborate and partner on and raise the level of awareness. And so you have, you know, a school that's being responsible in that way to make sure that not only are their students and their community made aware of it, but then they've extended and opened up their doors to the community as a whole. And so again, this is something that is free. It's tomorrow evening. I wanted to make sure we got that information out. It's tomorrow evening from what time and where?
From 5:00, it's only about 2 hours, 5 to 7. And it is at the Albright College Bowman Center. It's at the gym. So it's 1810 North 13th Street in Reading. You can't miss it. And we'll have, you know, we'll have markers for people to know where to go.
Wonderful. And I also heard you mention that there was some events that you attended at Reading Area Community College. And can you just kind of talk about that? Was that a health fair?
Yes, it was a health fair, but it was more focused on resources for their students. But obviously, you know, I think, you know, with the month being the month, I think they've kind of, you know, joined in. And, you know, so information was also provided, you know, as focused more, you know, obviously on the students. So.
Wonderful. And I'm just wondering if quickly you can kind of mention again, you know, you mentioned about classroom instruction. As it relates to different programs in the schools for our young people to just kind of raise the level of awareness. April, is there any specific avenue to talk about alcohol, or is that just kind of when you're talking about young people making good decisions, right? Making healthy decisions, we're inclusive of alcohol and other drugs.
Yes. And Too Good for Drugs is one of the curriculums that we use, and one of the we talk about alcohol, we talk about tobacco, and we also talk about marijuana. So alcohol is definitely always something that's, you know, mentioned in the curriculums when we go into the schools.
And does this continue? I also want to put a plug in for, we mentioning schools, but that also goes beyond the schools, even into the summer months. And if you want to quickly just kind of mention the summer programs, how do you determine where that prevention, education, and information continues? Is that in the parks? Is that among some other coordinating efforts, perhaps with all the Boys and Girls Club? Can you mention those things? Yes.
Yes, it is actually, we're in the process of contacting our playground leaders or, you know, the contacts, and we are gearing up for the summer programs to do exactly the same thing, but obviously in a more, you know, fun way, not kind of like in a classroom atmosphere. But yes, again, we talk about all of those things, and we also obviously include lots of fun learning all about these things and, you know, decision-making, like you mentioned, talking about pressure, peer pressure, and how the brain works. And so, yes, we do incorporate all of that. But, you know, again, we do it all in fun. So all in Berks County.
And I think it's worth mentioning that prevention is all year round. And because yes. What we know is during the summer months, youth are likely to experiment with using substances for the first time, even, particularly yes. When you're talking about there's no school, there's no structural programming for them to go to school.
Right.
So even during times whereby, you know, we don't say latchkey anymore, but there are times where young people are at home by themselves because mom and dad are working or their caregivers working. And so the opportunity to be curious, right, about vaping, about using alcohol for the first time actually increases during the summer months, which is why prevention is even more important now more
Absolutely.
Than ever that we educate our young people about being healthy and making good decisions.
Absolutely. I mean, if the kids aren't involved in any, you know, sports and school is out, then they're going to be bored. They're going to want to maybe, you know, be pressured into doing things that they wouldn't normally do because there's nothing else to do. And so, you know, summer programs are good. Like you mentioned, the Olivet's PAL. You know, Third and Spruce Recreation Center has all of these playgrounds with summer programs that are going to be gearing up, Muhlenberg, Exeter, all of these Berks County locations. So we're getting ready to do that, and things are looking good for that too. So
and again, our services are free.
Absolutely.
Wonderful. Well, Sonia, it is always a pleasure to speak with you. And thank you for your expertise and knowledge on prevention efforts and how we are working to make our communities more safe. And I do invite our home viewers, if you'd like more information about the Council on Chemical Abuse, please give us a call at 610-376-8669 or visit our website at COCAberks, that's COCAberks.org. In the meantime, this has been the Council on Chemical Abuse, Drug and Alcohol Update. Be well. Till next time, be safe. Thank you so much.